This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Worst Joke in the World. Author, Elisabeth Sanxay Holding. Chapter 1. Mrs. Champney was putting the very last things into her bag, and Mrs. Maxwell and Mrs. Dean sat watching her. The room in which she had lived for nearly 4 years was already strange and unfamiliar. The silver toilet articles were gone from the bureau. The cupboard door stood open, showing empty hooks and shelves. The little watercolors of Italian scenes had vanished from the walls, and the books from the table. All those things were gone, which had so charmed and interested Mrs. Maxwell and Mrs. Dean. They were old ladies, and to them Jessica Champney at 50 was not old at all. With her gaiety, her lively interest in life and her dainty clothes, she seemed to them altogether young, girlish even in her enthusiastic moments, and always interesting. They loved and admired her, and were heavy-hearted at her going. "You've forgotten the pussycat, Jessica," Mrs. Maxwell gravely remarked. "Oh, so I have," said Mrs. Champney. Hanging beside the bureau was a black velvet kitten with a strip of sandpaper fastened across its back, and underneath it the inscription, "Scratch my back." It was intended, of course, for striking matches. As Mrs. Champney never had occasion to strike a match, this little object was not remarkably useful. Nor, being a woman of taste, would she have admitted that it was in the least ornamental, but it was precious to her, so precious that a sob rose in her throat as she took it down from the wall. She showed a bright enough face to the old ladies, however, as she carried the kitten across the room and laid it in the bag. She had often talked to these old friends about her past, about her two heavenly winters in Italy, about her girlhood down east, about all sorts of lively and amusing things that she had seen and done, but she had said very, very little about the period to which the velvet kitten belonged. It had been given to her, in the early days of her married life, by a grateful and adoring cook. It had hung on the wall of her bedroom, in that shabby, sunny old house in Connecticut where her three children had been born. She could not think of that room unmoved, and she did not care to talk of it to anyone. Not that it was sad to remember those bygone days. There was no trace of bitterness in the memory. It was all tender and beautiful, and sometimes she recalled things that made her laugh through the tears, but even those things she couldn't talk about. There was, for instance, that ridiculous morning when Grandpa had come to see the baby, the unique and miraculous first baby. He had sat down in a chair and very gingerly taken the small bundle in his arms, and the chair had suddenly broken beneath his portly form. Down he crashed, his blue eyes staring wildly, his great white mustache fairly bristling with horror, the invaluable infant held aloft in both hands. If she had begun to tell about that, in the very middle of it, another memory might have come, a recollection of the day when she had sat in that same room, the door locked, her hands tightly clasped, her eyes staring ahead of her at the years that must be lived without her husband, her friend and lover. She had thought she could not bear that, but she had borne it, and the time had come when the memory of her husband was no longer an anguish and a futile regret, but a benediction. She had lived a happy life with her children. They were all married now, and in homes of their own, and she was glad that it should be so. These 4 years alone had been happy too. Her children wrote to her and visited her, and their family affairs were a source of endless interest. She had all sorts of other interests too. She made friends readily, she was an energetic parish worker, she loved to read, she enjoyed a matinee now and then, or a concert, and the conversation of Mrs. Maxwell and Mrs. Dean. With all her heart, she had relished her freedom and her dignity. Her children were always asking her to come and live with one or the other of them, but she had always affectionately refused. She believed it wasn't wise and wasn't right. She had stayed on in this comfortable, old-fashioned boarding house in Stamford, cheerful and busy. It had been a delight beyond measure to her to send a little check now and then to one of her children, a present to a grandchild, some pretty thing that she had embroidered or crocheted to her daughters-in-law. Her elder son's wife had written once that she was a real fairy godmother, and Mrs. Champney never forgot that. It was exactly what she wanted to be to them all. A gay, sympathetic, gracious fairy godmother. But she wasn't going to be one any longer. What her lawyer called a totally unforeseen contingency had arisen, and all her life was changed. He was a young man that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.